Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I am Dr. Uzma Shahzad. The topic we are going to discuss today is malignant ovarian tumors. The ovarian malignancies, they are a great challenge due to high mortality, and they make up to 6% of all the cancers in women, while 27% of gynecological cancers. 53% of the deaths of gynecological cancers, they are related to ovarian carcinoma. Thus, it's having a high fatality to case ratio. Its incidence is highest in Sweden and United States and is lowest in Japan. And incidence in India is up to 8.4 per 100,000 women. It is termed as a silent killer because it is asymptomatic in early stages, while 75% they are diagnosed in advanced stage disease with 5-year survival rate is 10 to 28%. And women lifetime risk of developing sporadic epithelial ovarian cancer is 1 to 1.5% in the developed nations, while 0.75% in India. And the mortality from ovarian cancer is up to 0.5%. Pathogenesis might be related to ovarian function with the trauma that results from ovarian cycles. Risk is increased with uninterrupted ovarian cycles, and multiple ovulations that are occurring will lead to repair that follows on the surface of the ovary. And sometimes the epithelium extends into ovarian stroma and will lead to formation of including glands and cysts. Thus, the first hypothesis that has been proposed for development of ovarian carcinoma is incessant ovulation. The other hypotheses include retrograde menstruation and retrograde transportation of carcinogens from the lower genital tract. Exposure of ovarian epithelium to persistently high gonadotropin levels is also proposed as a causative agent in development of ovarian carcinoma. Different risk factors that have been noticed related to ovarian cancer, they include age. It is rare before 40 years of age and increases thereafter and peaks at 65 to 75 years. While the patients who are having early menarche and late age as first child, or they are nulliparous at more than 30 years, and late menopause, they are all related to more ovarian cycles, and they are associated with increased risk of ovarian cancer. Nulliparity is the most important non-genetic factor involved in the development of ovarian carcinoma. Prolonged use of fertility drugs, especially without achieving pregnancy, with repeated ovarian stimulation and formation of multiple follicles and ovarian trauma, they are postulated as a causative agent for ovarian cancer. In patients who are having a history of breast cancer, they are more prone to develop ovarian cancer. And patients who are receiving hormone replacement therapy over 10 years, they are having increased risk of ovarian cancer up to 30%. Use of talcum powder in genital area is also a risk factor that leads to development of ovarian cancer. And there are certain protective factors that can be elicited in the history of the patient, like multiparous patients who are having their first pregnancy before the age of 30, and patients who are using oral contraceptives, they decrease the risk of ovarian cancer up to 11% per year due to suppression of ovarian function. And maximum suppression is up to 46% after 5 years of use. Tubal ligation also provides some protection, and hysterectomy with self-injectomy or fimbriectomy is a protective factor that has been postulated for development of ovarian cancer. Bilateral oophorectomy reduces the risk by 80% to 95%, and lactation is also having a protective role. Regarding the classification of ovarian cancer, we can classify it according to their pathological types. They may be arising from surface epithelium that are responsible for 80 to 90% of the cases, while non-epithelial origin ovarian cancers, they include germ cell tumors, which are present in 15 to 20% of the cases, and sex cord stromal tumors, in 5 to 8%. These are primary ovarian tumors, while secondary ovarian tumors that are arising due to primary at some other site, they are responsible for 20% of the cases. They may be either typical or atypical, like Rückenberg tumors. This table is showing the classification of the ovarian cancer. The first group is epithelial ovarian tumors. These may be benign, borderline, or malignant, and different types of ovarian cancers that are arising from epithelium have been reported. They include serous tumors, mucinous, endometrioid, clear cell, Brenner tumors, and mixed epithelial tumors, unclassified and undifferentiated. These are all different types arising from surface epithelium of the ovary. While stromal tumors include sex cord stromal tumors like granulosa cell tumors, androblastoma or Sertoli Leydig cell tumors, gynandroblastoma, and again unclassified type. And the other include Lippert cell tumors and germ cell tumors. Different germ cell tumors include distal melanomas, endodermal sinus tumor, which is also termed as York sac tumor, embryonal cell tumors, polyembryoma, choriocarcinoma, and teratoma. Gonadoblastoma is another type. Soft tissue tumors sometimes may be seen in ovaries which are not specific to ovaries, and unclassified and metastatic tumors are the rare types. Now we will describe all these tumors one by one. First of all are the epithelial tumors. These include the first type is serous tumors. These are formed by cells that are resembling the inner lining of the fallopian tubes. They are seen in 75% of the cancers arising from ovarian epithelium. And their occurrence is in 4th and 5th decades of life, and they are seen bilateral in 50% of the cases. The figure is showing bilateral serous tumors in a patient in whom the hysterectomy has been performed. The second type is mucinous tumors. They are responsible for 8 to 10% of the cases of ovarian tumors that are arising from surface epithelium. These are largest ovarian tumors, and sometimes they are filling the entire peritoneal cavity. Out of them, 5% are malignant, and 8 to 10% of the cases are bilateral. And these are usually cystic tumors having multiple loculi, and they are lined with mucin-secreting epithelium, and they are filled with mucinous material, and their cut surface is showing a honeycomb appearance. And if they are ruptured, they may lead to formation of pseudomyxoma peritonei and adhesion formation. Endometrioid tumors, they are present in 6 to 8% of cases of epithelial tumors. They are mostly unilateral, and 40% of the cases, they may be bilateral. Almost all of the endometrioid tumors, they are malignant. They are associated with endometrial cancer in association in up to 15 to 20% of the cases. And sometimes they are having concurrent endometriosis in 10 to 20% of the cases. They may be solid and cystic elements present in it. And the contents, they tend to be hemorrhagic rather than serous or mucinous in the endometrioid tumors. Clear cell tumors, they are showing clear peg-like or hobnail-like cells on histopathology. And they are mostly malignant. And 50 to 70% they are have endometriosis in association. And 1/4 of all the clear cell tumors, they arise in the lining of benign endometrioid cyst. These tumors are invariably high grade, grade 3, and hence they are not graded. Brenner tumors, they are responsible, they are resembling the internal lining of the urinary bladder. And borderline Brenner tumors, they need a surgical removal and will result in complete cure. While in malignant cases, which may be benign or borderline when coexisting with invasive transitional cell carcinoma, and when this transitional cell carcinoma is primary, it resembles transitional cell carcinoma of the urinary bladder without a recognizable Brenner. Tumor sensitive to chemotherapy and more favorable prognosis is seen in these patients. This again shows the classification of germ cell tumors according to their embryological origin, which we have already discussed. The secondary type of the ovarian tumor The important one is Krukenberg tumor. These are usually bilateral and they may arise from a primary carcinoma of the stomach in 70% cases, from large bowel in 15% and breast in 6%. They are usually having a smooth surface, slightly bossed or freely movable in the pelvis. No infiltration is seen through the capsule and no tendency to form adherence. This tumor retains the normal shape of the ovary with solid waxy consistency. Histologically, it is having a cellular or a myxomatous stroma, scattered Sigmoid cells, ring cells with ovoid granular cytoplasm, and nucleus is compressed against one pole of the cell. This describes all the pathological types of the ovarian cancers and their classification. Now, when a patient comes to us with some ovarian masses, they will have a range of symptoms that may be non-specific or vague, or sometimes they come with bloating and abdominal distension, or a chronic pelvic or abdominal pain is the presenting features. Patients, they might be having a difficulty in taking their food, or they are having a sensation of fullness, and urinary symptoms sometimes are there that may arise from pressure of the pelvic mass, like frequency and urgency. And symptoms, they are present for less than 1 year and they occur on more than 12 days per month. And on examination, patients, they are really anemic. They may have left supraclavicular or inguinal lymph nodes involved, and sometimes the unilateral non-pitting edema of the legs is there. These tumors are often bilateral and fixed and might be associated with ascites, any abdominal lump or enlarged liver due to secondaries. And vaginal examination will reveal fixed nodules in pouch of Douglas. Adnexal masses are felt separate from the uterus, and pleural effusion sometimes is there in stage 4. And starting with examination, we have to go for general physical examination, followed by abdominal and pelvic examinations, and then rectal examination. Starting with investigations, the most valuable clinical tool is by performing tumor marker, which out of which the important one is CA125. And here we can calculate the risk of malignancy index that will help in us in preoperative evaluation of the risk assessment in such cases. So the high risk cases, they can be referred to special oncological units for management. And the calculation of this RMI or risk of malignancy index is involving ultrasound findings, menopausal status of the patient, and the value of CA125. Thus, the U is the ultrasound score, and 1 point is given for each of the ultrasound features like multilocular cyst, solid areas, metastatic deposits, ascites, and bilateral lesions. While M is for menopausal status and scored as 1 for premenopausal ladies and 3 for postmenopausal ladies. And serum CA125 in international units per ml, it can vary between 0 and hundreds or even thousands of the units. The T yielded a sensitivity of 85% and specificity of 97%. And after calculation of this risk of malignancy index, we can segregate our patients as low risk, who are having an RMI value of less than 25. And patients are placed in the moderate risk group if their RMI levels are from 25 to 250, and high risk group having levels over 250. Where risk of malignancy index value is more than 250, then the risk of ovarian cancer is up to 75%. The other features seen on ultrasound and radiological examination, they have to be further investigated by imaging techniques like CT scan, MRI, and then we may perform the cytology or biopsy of the mass, and tumor markers. Other tumor markers are also performed in such cases. Regarding the staging of the ovarian cancer, we should be familiar with different stages of the ovarian cancer while we are going for management or staging laparotomy for such cases. So as we can perform the surgical staging and then we can manage our patients accordingly. In stage 1, tumor is confined to the ovaries and the 1A is confined to one ovary and 1B is confined to both of the ovaries. While 1C is either involving one ovary or both ovaries with rupture of the capsule or tumor on the surface of the ovary or positive peritoneal washing zoresitis. Thus, this is the stage 1 which is involving only ovaries, and in stage 1C there is surface involvement of ovary associated with ascites, and then is the stage 2. Here the tumor is involving one or both of the ovaries and there is pelvic extension that is seen below the pelvic rim involving either uterus and fallopian tubes in stage 2A, while it will extend to other pelvic intraperitoneal tissues in stage 2B, and stage 2C is either 2A or 2B with positive peritoneal washings or ascites. Third stage is involving one or both of the ovaries with cytologically or histologically confirmed spread to peritoneal surfaces outside the pelvis and mets to retroperitoneal lymph nodes. The stage 2 is confined to pelvis, while stage 3 is involving peritoneal surfaces outside the pelvis, and it's further subclassified as stage 3A, where there is a microscopic metastasis beyond the pelvis. Stage 3B is having a macroscopic extra pelvic peritoneal metastasis that are less than 2 cm in greatest dimension, while 3C is macroscopic extra pelvic peritoneal spread over 2 cm in greatest dimension, or sometimes there is involvement of the regional lymph nodes. These all are grouped as stage 3 of the ovarian cancer. While stage 4 is involving distant metastasis that are including peritoneal metastasis and hepatic parenchymal metastasis, pleural effluent, and so on. Once we have performed surgical staging, we must be aware of the prognostic factors that are affecting the outcome of treatment in these patients. And this depends upon the pathological type of the ovarian tumor or histological type. And this explains that clear cell and mucinous histologies are having a poor survival rate, and the histological types which are having a low malignant potential, they are having better survival. And it depends upon the grade of the tumor. Poorly differentiated types are having poor survival, and FIGO stage of the disease will be also determining the 5-year survival rate in these patients. Biological factors are related to aneuploidy or diploidy. Aneuploidy is associated with a poorer prognosis as compared to diploidy. And different clinical factors involved, they include extent of the residual disease post-primary surgery. That means when we are performing surgery, how much of the tumor bulk we have removed. It depends upon the volume of the disease. Small volume disease having a better prognosis despite the stage. And the age of the patient is also a determining factor for prognosis. Older age is associated with a poorer prognosis. Then, starting with the management of the ovarian cancer, we can go for different steps after a proper workup, performing history examination and investigations. Now we have planned for surgical staging of the ovarian cancer in these patients. For this, we have to go for preoperative evaluation, followed by surgical management and chemotherapy after surgery as required in certain cases, and then follow-up. The primary surgery in such cases, it depends upon the stage of the ovarian cancer. In early stages of the ovarian cancer, like stage 1 and stage 2A, comprehensive surgical staging or staging laparotomy is performed. And usually we can perform fertility sparing surgery in such cases. And while in advanced stage of the ovarian cancer, primary cytoreductive surgery is performed, followed by new adjuvant chemotherapy and interval cytoreductive surgery and laparoscopic surgery sometimes performed, and in certain cases we may have to go for a second look laparotomy in patients who are having a residual bulk of the disease or they are having recurrences. First of all is the comprehensive surgical staging, which we are performing in as a primary surgery in these patients, or which we are labeling as a staging laparotomy. For this we are giving vertical midline abdominal incision, and peritoneal cytology is taken, a minimum of 25 cc it should be sent. In the absence of ascites, separate saline washings are taken from cul-de-sac, right and left paracoli gutters, and from under surface of the diaphragm. Ovarian tumors are inspected for presence of papillary excrescences or rupture of the capsule. Abdominal inspection and palpation is done in a systematic function involving inspection of the bowel surfaces, omentum and lymph nodes, and so on. After primary surgery, we have to go for chemotherapy. The platinum based combination chemotherapy is generally recommended, and they can be used as a single drug or in combination. The drugs which are really used, they include paclitaxel and carboplatin, and in combination they are going to have a better survival rate. And different regimes are followed for these, which are beyond the scope of undergraduate students. And for this, you should remember that we are giving chemotherapy every 3 weeks, and we are monitoring patients' different blood tests like renal functions, liver functions, and serum electrolytes. And the number of cycles of treatments required in these patients, it depends upon the stage of the disease. In advanced stage disease, 6 to 8 cycles are required, while earlier stage disease, 3 to 6 cycles are required. After performing primary surgery and chemotherapy, we can expect a complete clinical remission in these patients, which is defined as no objective evidence of the disease left. And recommendation is after completion of the primary surgery and chemotherapy, we have to ask our patient for follow-up visits, which are performed every 2 to 4 months for 2 years, and then twice yearly for 3 years. After that, we will call patient annually for 5 years. And for every visit, we have to perform CA125 and other important tumor markers, which are significant for the type of the tumor. We have to perform complete blood counts, renal and liver functions. Complete physical and pelvic examination, abdominal examinations are performed. Different imaging techniques are performed, including chest abdominal x-rays, pelvic ultrasonography, CT scan, and MRI. And all of these are the tests which we are performing on follow-up patients. And regarding the 5-year survival rate in these patients who are undergoing surgery followed by chemotherapy with regular follow-up, it depends upon the stage of the disease. In first stage, 5-year survival rate is 60 to 76%, while in stage 2, 43 to 51%. Stage 3 is giving a 5-year survival rate of 17.5%, and stage 4 is having a poor survival, which is 4.7%. This completes the comprehensive discussion about the ovarian cancer risks, pathological types, its presentation and investigation, and followed by treatment, surgery, as well as chemotherapy. Hope so that everything is clear about ovarian cancers. For any queries, you can contact through college website. Thank you very much.